Guys, welcome to another video. You've got Mr. Everything English, and today we will address the topic that everyone seems to be dying about, and this is paper 2 question 5. Guys, everyone is now running, everyone is now focusing, everyone is now reading articles. How do I become a master of writing articles? Now, just in case you've been buried under a massive rock, guys, the exam boards announced that for your GCSEs in 2022, for paper 2 question 5, which is 50% of the paper, you will be writing an article. That's it. You will 100,000% be writing an article. Now, this will be the video where I will cover everything that you need to know about how to pull and write a grade 9 article. Now, as the video progresses, guys, it's gonna be broken down into a few sections. The first section, I will be going through the mark scheme and what you must apply. The second section, guys, I will be showing you guys a grade 9 answer. And the final section, guys, on the board, I will show you how to plan a grade 9 article. So hopefully, guys, this will become that one-stop video that you need when it comes to writing an article. All right, so guys, paper 2 question 5 is 50% of the exam, and we have been told that we are writing an article. Now, just because we are writing an article, nothing else has changed. The mark scheme remains the same, the timings remain the same. But for now, guys, I wanna go over what you will be marked upon. So for paper 2 question 5, guys, we all know it's a 45 minute question and it is worth 40 marks of your exam, which is equivalent to 50%. So it's a 45 minute question, it's worth 40 marks and it's worth 50%. And we are going to be writing an article. Now, whether it was an article, whether it was a speech, a letter, a blog, whatever the form was, the mark scheme remains the same. And this is why you have to become super duper familiar with the mark scheme, because we can't afford to miss up on that. Now, what is the mark scheme? So the first thing, guys, that the exam board look at for this question is they use the word compelling. They use the word compelling. Now, in about a couple of minutes, I'm gonna show you exactly what the exam board write in their mark scheme. But guys, they overcomplicate it so much and use such fancy terms that I wanna break it down to you guys as simple as possible, just so you can pick it up and use it in your exam. So they use the word compelling. All that means, guys, is your work interesting? That's it. Is your work interesting? Are your arguments interesting? Or are they weak? Now push that to one side for now. The next four points of the mark scheme that I'm going to cover, guys, these ones are what you have to do no matter what. Because my argument has always been that if you do these four successfully, your work will automatically become compelling. Now, what's the first point of the mark scheme? They say, guys, has the student used a range of language devices? So, guys, they ask, has the student used a range of language devices? Now, what does it mean by range? It means use different language devices. Don't just use simile, rhetorical question, simile, rhetorical question. Use different ones in your entire essay. Now, we have to be careful because we're doing an article. Now, which language device do people love using in articles? Facts and stats and expert opinion. Guys, please be careful. Don't flood your article. Don't flood your answer with random facts and stats. I spoke to 50 people and 50 people said they all agree with me. That's not realistic. Your facts and stats, there's two criteria. Number one, they have to be realistic. Number two, they have to support what you're saying. Don't just chuck in random facts. So guys, my advice is do it twice in your entire essay. Facts and stats, guys, just use them twice in your entire essay and you're done. Now, next one, guys, that people use a lot when it comes to language devices is expert opinion. I spoke to the Harvard professor or I spoke to Oxford University professor and he said that school uniform is really, really bad. Okay, what was the point of that expert opinion? Guys, if you're going to use an expert opinion, do it once. But again, make it fruitful, make it useful. Don't just think that if I write the words Harvard, I don't know, Harvard lecturer or Harvard expert, I'm gonna get any marks. Everything, every language device we use, they have to be varied, but they have to be effective, especially if you wanna get a grade 7, 8, or 9. So we must have a range of language devices. Then guys, in our writing, we must include a range of punctuation. Now this is not including commas and full stops. Every single person watching this video should have the basic idea that in an English language GCSE exam, I have to use commas and full stops correctly. When it's talking about a range, it's talking about semicolons, colons, exclamation marks, question marks, brackets. We have to include that in our essay. Now later when I plan an answer, I will show you guys how you use these in a response. Next guys, now this is an important one, especially for those of you looking for a grade 8 or a 9. You have to include ambitious vocabulary. Guys, you have to include ambitious vocabulary. It doesn't say good vocabulary. It doesn't say decent vocabulary. It says ambitious vocabulary, which means, in other words, super, super, super big words. Don't say coronavirus is a really bad idea or a really bad disease. The word bad is terrible. Say coronavirus is heinous. So guys, you need to make sure you're using high level ambitious vocabulary. If you don't know any words, simply use www.thesaurus.com and they will give you all the words you need. I'm pretty sure guys, thesaurus.com should be sponsoring this video because the amount of shout outs I give them, I truly deserve a sponsor. No, I'm kidding. Last one guys. The last thing we need to include in our writing guys is structural devices. Now the only ones that I would like to consciously focus on are long sentences, short sentences, long paragraphs, short paragraphs, a cyclical structure, and dialogue. These are the six that I would like you to consciously focus on. Now, what do we mean by consciously? I mean, really make an effort to use them in your writing so they're effective. The other ones, like zooming in, zooming out, shifting focus, I truly believe you will do that naturally as a writer. But the six that I mentioned are the ones that I really want you to consciously focus on. Now guys, that's it. There's your mark scheme. So we're doing an article, 50%, 40 marks, 45 minute question. And in our article, we must include these things. And now I want to address one last point before we go over the grade 9 answer. Headings and subheading titles and pictures and columns. Guys, we're not in year 7 and 8. Doing lovely articles where we get a ruler and draw nice columns and we do bubble writing for the heading and then we have nice little subheadings. This is a GCSE exam. We ain't got time to be artists. The only thing that I need you to do in your exam is include a title. In that title, use either a rhetorical question or use alliteration and that's it. I don't want no subheadings. I don't want no subheading titles. I don't want no pictures. Now you can do it if you want. I'm just advising you that I think it's a waste of time because it doesn't contribute to the mark scheme. You're just doing it because that's what you think an article should look like. But we're not actually writing an article that's going to be published. We're doing a GCSE exam and this is the mark scheme. So guys, have a heading and off you go. Now guys, before we do, before I go and talk you guys through how to plan an answer, I want to show you guys a grade 9 answer. Now this grade 9 answer guys was published by AQA. So I didn't write it nor did I mark it. AQA published it and they graded it 40 out of 40. So they said that this answer was full marks. Now the reason I want to go over the grade 9 answer is honestly guys, I want to back up what I'm saying. Sometimes I can stand here and say guys do all this, but I really want to prove to you guys how this is all you need to do to smash your exam. Don't get lost in the noise. All right, guys, let's now look at that grade 9 answer.
So guys, this is an example of a question, and let's just quickly go over it. Section B, writing, you were advised to spend about 45 minutes, guys. So that is the timing confirmed. We must write in full sentences. We are recommended to plan our answer, and we should leave enough time to check our work at the end. Those are some basics when it comes to the question. To be honest with you guys, all it is common sense. Now I want to go over an example of a question. People have become obsessed with traveling ever further and faster. However, travel is expensive, dangerous, damaging, and a foolish waste of time. Write an article for a new website in which you argue your point of view on this statement. 24 marks are available for your content and 16 marks available for your accuracy, giving you a total mark of 40. Now, I want to go back, guys, and I want to focus on the question, because I want you guys to look at one very important thing, and it's a quick question 5 hack. The exam boards, guys, because in English, there's no higher or foundation paper, the exam boards always give you hints and give you clues of some of the arguments that you can use in your exam. So, for example, when it comes to this statement, there's one side of the argument that is stronger than the other, and that is agreeing with the statement. It is easier to agree with the statement than it is to disagree with the statement. And I'm going to tell you why. The simple answer, guys, is because the exam board has given us clues on possible arguments that we can use. And they do this in every single question 5. So we're going to argue that yes, we agree 1000% with this statement. And here's our paragraphs. Paragraph 1, we're going to speak about how travel... In paragraph 1, we will speak about how travel is expensive. In paragraph 2, we will speak about how traveling... Paragraph 1, how it's expensive. Paragraph 2, we will speak about how it is dangerous. Paragraph 3, how it is damaging. And paragraph 4, guys, we can talk about how it's a foolish waste of time. Now, obviously, we have to add our own detail to these points. But I'm just showing you guys an example that sometimes the answers are in the question if you look close enough. Now, that's the question, an example of a question. Now, guys, I want to very quickly run through the mark scheme that I went over earlier. Now, guys, I said it before, guys, you're marked out of 24 and you're marked out of 16. Now, to get 24 marks, to get anywhere close to 24 marks, we have to do the following. And I've talked about this earlier, guys. The first thing you must do is your writing must be compelling, meaning your writing must be interesting. And at the same time, it must be convincing. What that means is whatever arguments you use to answer the question, you must convince the reader of them by the end of your essay. Second one, guys, you must match the purpose. That means have you answered the question and have you written it based upon your audience? Now, that stuff, guys, I'm not too bothered about because I genuinely believe we will do it anyway. It's this bottom part that we must focus on. First thing, guys, it says you must use ambitious vocabulary. But look at the word before it. It says it must be extensive. This means you must use a lot of ambitious vocabulary. One or two words don't cut it. Then it says you must sustain. Now, when you sustain something, you keep it up. You must sustain the use of language devices. So paragraph 1 has to have language devices. Paragraph 2 and paragraph 3 and paragraph 4 have to have language devices. It must be sustained. But those language devices, if you want to get 22, 23, 24 marks, they have to be crafted. Now, what does that mean? Guys, your language devices have to be of a high quality. Every man and his dog uses the language device. He ran like a cheetah. That's not a high quality language device. That's not a crafted language device. When it says crafted, it's talking about have you used language devices and vocabulary at a high level. Let's move on, guys. You must have a range, so varied. You must have a range and you must make good use of structural features, long sentence, short sentence. A lot of students, guys, they think that just by having a long paragraph or a short paragraph or a long sentence or a short sentence, that's enough. No, it has to be effective in our writing. Now, this one, guys, for this question should be easy. We must link our paragraphs. Don't make your essay sound as though you're writing four different paragraphs. Each paragraph should build up on the earlier paragraph. So use language like furthermore, in addition, moreover, as a result. Connect your writing. Now this is, now guys, all of this is what you have to do to get 24 or anywhere near 24. And it has to be of a high quality. Now, we've already been over this because I've broken this down earlier. Once you've been marked out of 24, you were then marked out of 16. Now, look at how they break this down, guys. It makes me laugh. The first one says, sentence demarcation is consistently secure and accurate. Basically, guys, make sure you're using full stops and capital letters properly. Next one, you must use a wide range of punctuation. And this must be used accurately. So we can't just use full stops and commas. You must use question mark, exclamation mark, brackets, semicolon, colon, and so on. Now, if you're going to use long and short sentences, make sure you use them for effect. Don't just chuck them in there and think you're going to get anywhere near the top band. Next one, guys, please make sure you use standard English. I don't want to see lol, bro, cuzzy. Please write in full English using full words and so on. Next one, guys, please make sure your spelling is on point. Even in the big words you are using, please make sure your spelling is on point. And there's no excuses, guys. If you're aiming for a top band answer, you should learn your ambitious vocabulary spelling off by heart. And finally, guys, they say it again. They want to make sure you are using ambitious vocabulary in your writing. Please use ambitious vocabulary in your writing. Now, guys, I've been over this. I just went over a couple of minutes ago, but I just wanted to show you guys what the exam board have actually written on paper. So this is what they have written, and I've broken that down previously just so you guys can understand. Now let's go over a grade 9 answer. This is a grade 9 answer, guys, that has been published by AQA, and they gave this answer 40 out of 40. First question, guys, do you see a subheading? Do you see subtopics? Do you see columns? Do you see a picture? No. All they've got and they begin is with a heading, to fall or to fly. Now, shall we read it? Let's read maybe the first paragraph or two. The rest of it, guys, you guys can have a look at it in your own time. I'll put a link to the file in the description. Also, guys, I've been over it in my TikToks, so I'll just go over the first paragraph or two. Every parent has experienced the indescribable joy of when they see their child for the first time, and feelings of an uncontrollable protective nature are difficult to suppress. As a parent, it's an undisputed duty to look after your child, your kin, your flesh and blood, because their safety means everything in the world. You teach them how to cross a road. You teach them the ABCs, how to ask for help, what to do if they're lost and don't know where their mommy or daddy is. It's an innate desire to protect, and it only becomes more difficult in formative adolescent years when it's expected to parents to let go. But nowadays, more than ever, it seems that parents have become more and more unwilling to allow their children to leave the nest. Let's mark this particular student's work. Let's begin, guys, firstly, by looking at the punctuation. So we see a semicolon, we see a semicolon, we see dash over here. So, and we see a semicolon over here again. So do they get the mark for punctuation? Most definitely. Then let's have a look at their structure. Over here, guys, we have a very long list. You teach them how to cross a road. You teach them how the ABCs, how to ask for help, what to do if they're lost and don't know where their mummy or daddy is. So we have a list and we have punctuation. We also have repetition, guys, of the word you is being repeated over and over again. You. So punctuation is done. structure is also done. Now, next, let's have a look at their vocabulary. Has this student used good vocabulary? If I was marking their work, yep, the word indescribable is a decent word. The word undisputed is a decent word. The word uncontrollable, formative adolescent. I like the way they've worded it. So yeah, they would get the mark for vocabulary also. Finally, guys, let's have a look at the language devices. Every parent, they begin with the hyperbole, because obviously this doesn't apply to every parent. Your kin, your flesh, your blood, they've used a rule of three. And here, guys, allowing their children to leave the nest, they've used a metaphor because they've compared their home to a nest. So if I was applying the mark scheme that we've just seen to this particular paragraph, guys, 100%, they've ticked off. Guys, 100%, they've ticked off the entire mark scheme. And that is all you do in all the other paragraphs of your writing. Like a robot, you include structure, you include range of punctuation, language devices, and punctuation in your response over and over and over again. Now, I've spoken to you guys about the mark scheme. I've shown you guys a grade 9 answer. Now, guys, this question in front of you, I am now going to plan a paragraph for this question, and eventually I will write out a response for you guys to see. So guys, now that we've been over the mark scheme and now that you've seen a grade 9 response, let's look at how you actually begin writing your own article. The first thing, guys, that I would like you all to include in your article is a title. That's step number one. I would like every single one of you guys to make sure that you've got a title in your writing. Now, this title, guys, or this heading is literally a 10-second job. In it, you want to either include, if possible, a rhetorical question or the language device of alteration. And that is all you need for the title. And then we move on to our first paragraph. And this is the introduction. Guys, this is the introduction. Now, for the introduction, guys, we are looking to spend no more than 2.5 minutes. And it is in the introduction, guys, where we introduce our first main, sorry, our arguments. What side are we arguing? What are we talking about in this essay? We want to introduce our topic. We want to introduce our argument. Now, after you spend 2.5 minutes on the intro, guys, we then move on to main paragraph one. Now, this is where we begin to pick up our marks. Now, on our main paragraph, guys, we are spending 10 minutes. This is our first strong argument. And this is where we're going to show off our language device and our vocabulary and so on. Now, after you've done your first main paragraph, you then insert a one-line paragraph. You then, guys, insert a one-line paragraph. And I'm actually being serious, guys. Please make sure it's one line. Now, the reason I want it to be one line is because I want you to put the examiner in a position where they have to give you the mark for structure. So really give them a one-line paragraph. Ask a question, do whatever you want, but just insert a paragraph of one line. Now, after you've done your one-line paragraph, which will take you no more than about 30 seconds, you are then moving on to our main paragraph two and our main paragraph three. And on both of these, we are spending no more than 10 minutes each. Then after we've written our second and third main paragraph, we then insert one more one-line paragraph, because again, guys, we want to get the mark for structure. We want to ensure, guys, we want to ensure that we're putting the exam board in a position where they are left with no choice but to give us the mark. Now, after, guys, you've done your one-line paragraph or your final one-line paragraph, you begin to come to the end. And this is when we insert our final main paragraph. So main paragraph four
and then we spend 10 minutes on this paragraph also. So guys, if we track it so far, we spend 10 minutes, which is 40 minutes. We spent 2.5 minutes on the introduction, which is 42.5 minutes. And then we insert our conclusion. Guys, then we insert our conclusion. And here we are looking to spend 2.5 minutes. Now guys, this is the structure that I would really like you all to try and follow. Now, we have 45 minutes for this question. And if you look on the board, we spent 45 minutes. Now, you may be saying, oh, sir, but look, you've got a one-line paragraph here and a one-line paragraph there, and you've got a title. Guys, that's like literally max, to put it all together is 1 minute. Your title, let's say the article is about lockdown being really bad. Your title, is lockdown the worst thing to ever happen to humans? Just do it and move on. Don't dwell upon the title. Don't dwell upon the heading. If you're really sitting there and you can't think of a title, forget it. Don't bother. But it is not worth taking time in your exam. Now, this one-line paragraph and this one-line paragraph, guys, how long does it take to write one line? 10 seconds? So we are not spending a lot of time on these three. The bulk of your time is there, and there. Now, if it comes down to it and you're running out of time and you're thinking, what shall I cut out? Guys, you want to start cutting out maybe your conclusion. But in an ideal world, that's the structure you're aiming for. 45 minutes, 4 main paragraphs, small intro, small conclusion, 2 one-line paragraphs, and your heading. Which is absolutely possible, because essentially, guys, this should take up maybe 2 to 3 sides of writing. Now I want to show you guys how you plan one paragraph for an essay. How do you plan one paragraph? The question, guys, that we're going to focus on is the one about people have become obsessed with traveling ever further and faster. However, traveling is expensive, dangerous, damaging, and a foolish waste of time. I'm going to argue that I agree 1000% with this statement. And on the board, I'm going to plan one paragraph just so you can see how you plan and pull off a paragraph for this particular paragraph. We begin with thinking of our main argument. What's the main argument of this particular paragraph? So for example, guys, let's say I wanted to argue that traveling is really, really bad. Traveling is really, really bad because traveling is dangerous. So my first argument is traveling is dangerous. This is the main topic of my paragraph. I must now find and write down 2 ways traveling is dangerous. Guys, I must now write down 2 ways traveling is dangerous. Now I'm going to speak about public transport. For example, guys, I may talk about Uber and how it's not safe because maybe some of the drivers are not CRB checked, whatever. But that could be my one argument. My second argument, guys, is I could talk about accidents and maybe the death rate when it comes to traveling by a plane or traveling in cars and so on. So those are my 2 points that I'm going to make from my main point. Now, the reason we have 2 points is because so many times when it comes to paper 2, question 5, people's paragraphs are too short. By having a main point with 2 sub-points, we will ensure that our paragraph isn't short. We will ensure that we've written enough. Now, this top half of the paragraph, which I've just done, guys, this top half of the paragraph, which I've just done, this would count as my content. Let me write that again, but this time, let me write it on the board. Guys, this would count as the content. Now, your content, guys, just so you're aware, is worth 24 marks, and this is what you are writing. So, in this paragraph, I am writing this. The second half of the paragraph, which we are now about to do, guys, this is the language, and this is word 16, and this is how we are writing. It is a beautiful blend of content plus language, which will get you the high marks. Now, guys, look back to our mark scheme. The mark scheme said that we have to have a range of language devices in our writing. Now, for this one, guys, it's a given. I have to use facts or statistics because I'm talking about death rates. For this one over here, guys, let's say I'll use personification, which is when you give a non-human human qualities. So I've got facts and statistics on this side, and I've got personification on this side. So that's the language device element of the mark scheme ticked off. Next, it was talking about punctuation. In this paragraph, I would like to use an exclamation mark. In this paragraph, guys, I would like to use an exclamation mark. And finally, guys, it's the vocabulary. In this paragraph, I will use the word heinous, and let's use the word lackadaisical, because you guys know that I love this particular word. Now, that's it, guys. That is a full plan for one paragraph. Now, think about it. If I followed the same plan for my four paragraphs, that means each paragraph will have two different language devices, one different piece of punctuation, and two different ambitious words. As a minimum, this is what I'm doing. Guys, it's a bulletproof way of hitting the mark scheme. Now look at the time, guys. That took me, a couple of minutes to plan? Practice. You should honestly, guys, learn this bottom part off by heart. You should know that in your exam in June, in paragraph one, I will be using a simile, metaphor, this vocabulary, this punctuation. In paragraph two, I will be using this. Learn the bottom half off by heart, and all you do on the day is you tweak the top to fit the question. Now, guys, one more thing that I want to do before we end this video is I want to write this paragraph out for you guys, because I want you guys to see how you actually turn your plan into a paragraph, because this is worth nothing. It's what I produce from it, which is worth a lot of marks. So guys, I know this is becoming a long video, but really do use it as your one-stop shop when it comes to how to write an article. We'll write out this paragraph, and then hopefully, guys, we'll stop the video.
Guys, let's begin writing up the response that I planned a second ago, and just so you can see how a paragraph may look. Now, guys, I've not rehearsed this response. I'm literally going to type as I talk, and let's hope I produce something decent. Otherwise, that would be rather embarrassing. So let's begin, guys. So we're talking about how traveling is dangerous. The whole world has no choice but to travel. Now, the reason I began with talking about the whole world is because I want the reader, in this case, the examiner, to realize that I'm trying to make my argument persuasive. Every single person is affected. The whole world has no choice but to travel. However, simply because traveling has become a necessity, does it mean we are doing it right? So I began, guys, with a question to get the reader thinking. Transport for London. Let's come in with a strong statistic to get the reader on side. Recently released a harrowing means really, really bad, statistic claiming, let's say 20%, I think 20% is decent, that there had been a 20% rise, let's do road, in road accidents. Now, saying 20% in 1 year, guys, is a little bit too unrealistic. So let's do, there had been a 20% rise in road accidents over the past 5 years. 5 years is not bad. Let's even make it even better with the statistics. 4%. 4% of these resulting in life threatening injuries. Now you may think that 4% is not a lot. Now guys, I'm trying to engage the reader now. You may even think that you are safe because you never travel into London. Let's link it to like a disease. But the danger of travel should and needs to be viewed as a disease. As a disease, as a disease. And it is slowly but surely spreading. The danger, let's move on to my second point, which was about public transport. The danger does not stop with these heinous accidents. The danger continues when we think of our safety on public transport. Let's do buses and taxis because they're the most popular. From knife crime on buses to sexual assault in taxis. We can no longer treat this danger in a lackadaisical manner. Let's do the personification. Before we know it, we will be a nation ambushed. That's my personification, guys. Ambushed by traveling. I'm gonna end it now soon, guys, because it's getting quite hefty. Traveling after not because. Can you guys still see the board? Yes, you can. Not because traveling itself is a problem. But because, because the current state of traveling is far too dangerous. And if we continue to ignore this over and over again. Guys, I'm going to end it here with an emotional plea. We will fail to protect one another as citizens of this guys, my fat fingers can't type, of this beautiful world. Alright guys, and there is, and that is where guys I will end my writing. Now let's go back to my plan. In my plan I said that I will be using the word heinous and the word lackadaisical. There's the word heinous, and somewhere over here I've used the word lackadaisical. In my plan guys, I also said that I will be using an exclamation mark. Now here, over here guys, is where I used my exclamation mark. In my plan guys, I also said that I will be using facts and statistics, and this entire part over here is where I used my first language device, which was facts and stats. Then guys, I also said that I will be using personification, and when I spoke about how we will be ambushed by traveling, this is a language device, sorry, this is personification, because traveling does not hold the ability to ambush us. Now, if I was to look at this answer as a whole guys, I have used lots of other punctuation. For example, I've got a semicolon over here, I've got a question mark over here, but what I want to show you guys is the importance of sticking to your plan. You have to stick to your plan, because as a minimum it will make you hit the mark scheme. I don't care if you add other stuff, of course go crazy and add as many language devices, as much vocabulary, as much punctuation as you want, but as a minimum we must stick to the mark scheme. Now, what am I proposing? We use two ambitious words per paragraph, two language devices per paragraph, and one piece of punctuation per paragraph. Now, if this was an actual essay, this is my first paragraph. The paragraph after this would be my one-line paragraph, so to ensure it's a short sentence, and then I would carry on. And guys, there you have it. That's how you turn a plan into a paragraph. Guys, if you're still watching this video, then I would like to say firstly thank you for watching it up to now, and secondly well done, because I hope you've learned something of benefit. Now when I was planning this video guys, initially I was thinking maybe break it down into a series of videos, but then I thought, look, if that was me, I'd rather have one video that has everything I need than me having to search 10,000 clips looking for bits of information. So guys, please do use this video when you're preparing for your exams. We know the exam is on how to write an article, so please do use this video to prepare yourselves. All right guys, I'll end this video over here. As always guys, thank you for your support. Until next time, it's been Mr. Everything English.